Good morning, bonjour. I am pleased to welcome you to the Open Caucus. I'm Art Eagleton, a senator from Toronto, co-chair for the meeting, and beside me is my co-chair, Senator Claudette Tardy from Alberta. Through this Open Caucus initiative, we are opening our doors to Canadians, parliamentarians, and to the media. We want to learn about and discuss issues of national importance. This effort is hosted by the Senate Liberal Caucus, but is intended to be nonpartisan. We welcome and encourage a variety of opinions during these discussions. To mark Cybersecurity Awareness Month, the topic of today's meeting is the state of cybersecurity in Canada. Canada is one of the most digitized countries in the world, with our online presence taking a primary role in our personal lives, in business transactions, and governmental national security sectors. Canadians have come to rely on technology for the exchange of sensitive and private information. This reliance makes us susceptible to online threats from hacktivists, from criminals, and from foreign entities. Such targeted threats have a range of impacts, ranging from mental health issues to loss of finances to some very serious national security concerns. We've been reading a lot lately about the hacking that may be going on in the United States relevant to their election, which they say comes from Russia. There was a shutdown of part of the Ukraine electrical system not too long ago, which again they say comes from Russia. And then there is a rather substantial suggestions that perhaps China is involved in some security breaches, particularly in the U.S. Office of Personnel Management. So these are all serious issues, personally, business-wise, and for our governments. Today we shall address the current landscape of cybersecurity and what steps can be taken to make Canada a leader in the promotion and protection of online data and other systems. Coffee, logistic stuff now. Coffee, tea is available at the back there, as you can see if you turn around. Translation is available. These devices are around and about, including in the seats in front of me. Channel 1 is for English. Channel 2 is for French. And let me also point out that we encourage audience participation. That's the folks right in front of me. So if you at some point want to have an intervention, a quick question or a comment, microphone 5 I see is set up for that purpose, and just get the attention of that blonde fellow down at the end, Mike Delaney, or the lady next door, Agnes Barr-Kluman, from my staff. They'll get it all written up for me and get it up to me, and we'll try to integrate it with the questions and comments that are made by the senators. So with that, Senator Tardy.
Merci, Senator Eagleton. Bonjour, bon matin. Il me fait également plaisir de vous souhaiter la bienvenue à cette rencontre du caucus ouvert. Je remercie les conférenciers d'avoir accepté de nous rencontrer ce matin. Comme le sénateur Eagleton l'a mentionné, notre pays est l'un des plus numérisés au monde. Notre présence en ligne joue un rôle important dans nos vies personnelles, les opérations commerciales et les secteurs publics. Une telle dépendance nous expose davantage aux menaces en ligne de cybermilitants, de criminels et d'entités étrangères. Des menaces ciblées peuvent avoir diverses conséquences, allant de problèmes de santé mentale aux pertes financières, sans oublier les questions de sécurité nationale. Pour alimenter la discussion, nous recevrons 4 conférenciers issus de différents horizons qui ont généreusement accepté notre invitation. Alors, sans plus tarder, passons aux présentations de nos conférenciers.
Merci. We'll now proceed with our panelists making their comments of about 7 minutes each, and then I'll go to senators and to the floor beyond that. The first of our four panelists today is David Murakami Wood, who is cross-appointed professor between sociology and geography at Queen's University and the Canadian Research Chair of Surveillance Studies at Queen's. He is editor-in-chief of Surveillance and Society, the International Journal of Surveillance Studies, and a founding member of the Surveillance Studies Network. David, professor?
Okay, thank you. Okay, I want to make these points briefly and rather formally, given the time that we have. I have a number of them, so I'll try not to go over time. The first thing I want to say is that cybersecurity seems like it is something big and new and dangerous. However, I would first like to emphasize there is nothing fundamental about cybersecurity that makes it an extraordinary threat. Its means are technical, and its solutions are frequently also most simply technical and sometimes behavioral. The biggest threat to security of information systems, threats in order, are firstly failure and accident, secondly human beings, and finally, that is human users, and finally and least likely of all, intrusion and attack. And even many attacks are really exploiting human beings as much as technical systems themselves. And one can think of examples from everyday individual versions like spear phishing through to attacks like Stuxnet, which was actually more about exploiting human beings than systems, even though we focus on the systemic. Second point, the simplest form of cybersecurity is not to connect, is disconnection. This is an important point to bear in mind at a time when there is a mania for connecting everything, not just what one would formally call computers or information systems, but all kinds of things via the so-called Internet of Things. Connection always means more openness and vulnerability, and every security action taken after connection is mitigation of risk. It should not be forgotten that if it serves no necessary democratic or public purpose to connect an information system, don't. Third point. Network intrusions are not necessarily equivalent to real-world analogs, and I would be warned against people making analogies too freely. Theft online, cyber theft, is not theft in the traditional sense, since no one is permanently deprived in most cases of property. However, the law has accepted it as an analogy. The more important point here is that cyber war is not warfare. And I think it's very important we make this point, because if one starts to accept these analogies, this rhetoric actually transfers control and ownership of a problem. So cyber war implies something military, and therefore military ownership of the problem and potentially military response. And that can mean military response in the real world. And indeed, we have seen examples of this being said recently. Related to this, there are a number of other kinds of myths. And in fact, the portrayal and understanding of cybersecurity in the public domain, and especially in the media and sometimes in policy, is dominated by myths and myth-making. For example, one of the foundational stories of computer network intrusion is the so-called Siberian pipeline explosion in the early 1980s, which apparently was a Soviet-era oil pipeline that was attacked using an early Trojan, and that caused an explosion. As Thomas Ridd has pointed out in his book, Cyber War Will Not Take Place, there is no evidence this even happened. It was a later story there is no actual historical evidence for this event even taking place, yet it has become a foundational story. In fact, the technical means suggested that how this event might have taken place were probably impossible at the time. So beware of post hoc hearsay and whispers. Some persistent myths about cybersecurity are even based on popular film, war games, hackers, and so on. And even within, by the way, the cybersecurity community, these things sometimes circulate. Another myth, number five, loss estimates from cybersecurity breaches are another area of high rhetoric and low facts. Overblown actuarial statements of loss based on entirely notional values designed for insurance claims and insurance policies are taken for granted when network intrusions occur. Yet there is very little reason to accept any of these statements about loss. Most of them turn out to be very poorly quantified, massively overestimated, and if added together, would actually cause financial meltdown for the entire economic system, which obviously is not happening, so it's clearly not true. Sixth point, cybersecurity and national security. Is cybersecurity a national security concern? I ask this question because increasingly it's portrayed as if it naturally was a national security concern. Most cybersecurity is really about commercial and private systems. However, clearly in a neoliberal economic climate, facilitating the aims and concerns of business are taken as the natural task of government, and that includes information network security. Perhaps, however, we need to assign more responsibility to private, commercial, and non-governmental entities for cybersecurity. In many cases, they do it better, they know more, and they should take more responsibility for these things. Economic motivation should, one thinks, be enough if one accepts neoliberal rhetoric. However, strong legal sanction for failure to protect systems might also be required. Point seven. However, even recognizing that there is a national security issue, which I do, and recognizing that there are national and state systems, which there are, the attitude of states towards national cybersecurity sometimes seems to be inexplicable. I refer, for example, to the recent decisions around moving government information in Canada to the cloud. The cloud, by the way, which has a real geography, a real material geography, it's not just in the air, most of it is in the US, in North America, is a systemic sort of entity, a way of storing information that will inevitably at some point bring Canadian information and privacy law into conflict with those of other jurisdictions. And it is not enough to assert that Canadian law applies to Canadian information wherever it is. This is a pious hope, and I think in the post-Snowden era, if we've learned nothing, that kind of piety should now be dead. Eight. The role of state security agencies in protecting the information security of citizens. For me, fundamentally, what the state should be doing when it comes to cybersecurity is making security effective for all. This means promoting and making encryption work, not undermining it. Making backdoors, weakening standards, and so on is the practice of insecurity, not cybersecurity. In imagining that this makes things easier for state agencies to pursue their own agendas, systemic weaknesses are created across the information ecosystem. Agencies should not increase systemic insecurity. This applies particularly when weaknesses are discovered. These should not be hidden to be possibly exploited later by state or other agencies, but should be publicly announced so that they can be fixed and increase the general public security. This is a real cybersecurity job that agencies responsible for cybersecurity should have as their first priority. Distributed, secure, and fixable systems are inherently stronger than centrally controlled and purposefully flawed ones. Again, a lot of this argument means giving more power and trusting more in non-governmental organizations and private actors, not trusting them less. The regulation of the use of powers that relate to state cybersecurity should also be carefully scrutinized and guard against new forms of technological and task creep, that is, the extension of what were previously limited tasks into new areas without oversight or scrutiny. For example, Bill C-51, which is currently being revised and being reconsidered in a process the government has instituted, was notoriously vague and allows this kind of drift from, for example, targeting conventional online forms of terrorism as well as real-world terrorism to any group that supposes state interests. Although the government stated this is not the case, the law as it is written clearly allows for such drift to take place. Three more points. Finally, privacy and the vanishing of surveillance. The combination of the increasing complexity of technology and the increasing integration of surveillance tech with consumer tech is resulting in the vanishing of surveillance from the sight of the citizen. The vanishing of surveillance technology sets up a situation where users have every right to believe that they are maintaining their privacy when in fact they are under the gaze of various forms of surveillance. The question here is how the Canadian government and the Canadian state can balance surveillance in the context of national security with the need to maintain privacy as a human right, which should be one of the fundamental jobs of all security. It's opposed to security. This is the job of security. It's what we are securing, fundamentally, is our human rights and our privacy. Number 11, I've got two more points. What are the impacts of changes to the regulation of cybersecurity on existing and the currently negotiated commitments in areas as diverse as human rights and trade? I asked this because I was very surprised to discover at an equivalent high-level meeting in Japan a couple of years ago on the revamp of privacy law that such matters had not even been considered, even though there are provisions in several international trade regimes for challenges to domestic laws and policies which constitute a restraint of trade or which affect expected future investments and profits. We've seen this recently with wind farm investment, of course, in Ontario, but this could apply across the board to regulations like privacy, various kinds of human rights regimes that might conflict in some way with international treaty requirements on trade and other areas. Finally, oversight and transparency are the key. This is the message I'm going to leave you with. If cybersecurity increasingly vanishes into the black hole of security intelligence agencies and is subject to military intelligence norms of secrecy, it makes accountability increasingly unlikely. Even accurate data on aggregate numbers for how often tools or legal exemptions are used is hard to come by. And this can only get worse if we go further down this route. In order to make informed decisions in a democracy, this culture of secrecy needs to be reduced to where it is absolutely necessary. Information security is as much about openness and about transparency and knowledge as it is about closure and secrecy. That's all I'm going to say in this introductory statement. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Murakami Wood, for your very interesting and thought-provoking presentation. Là, j'ai le plaisir de présenter Monsieur Claude Sarrazin. Claude Sarrazin est président fondateur de Circo, une entreprise qui réalise des enquêtes et des audits sur les délits informatiques, ce qui comprend le vol de données, les fuites de renseignements et les tentatives de prise de contrôle. Sa firme a été retenue par les Nations Unies pour enquêter sur certains cybercrimes. Il siège également sur de nombreux conseils d'administration, dont celui du Centre international de prévention de crimes. Il est président du Conseil de l'Association professionnelle des enquêteurs privés du Québec. Bienvenue, M. Sarrazin. La parole est à vous.
Merci. Merci de me recevoir ici. Je suis un praticien du domaine. Donc, ce que je vois sur le terrain est, de façon générale, que des problèmes. Donc, je n'ai pas une perception du facteur préventionniste, si on veut. Je vais commencer un peu à l'envers la problématique de la cybersécurité parce que c'est un problème et un enjeu qui est majeur et qui est d'une complexité importante. Je vais commencer avec un exemple. Il y a quelques années, peut-être un petit peu plus, disons 25, on m'a demandé s'il était possible de bâtir une résidence parfaitement sécuritaire. À la grande surprise de mon interlocuteur, et après quelques questions pour m'assurer que l'on parlait bien de crimes communs et non de guerre nucléaire, j'ai répondu oui. Et comment, me dit-il, sourire en coin? Très simple. On va construire un bâtiment en béton armé, sans porte ni fenêtre. Les personnes et leurs biens qui se trouvent à l'intérieur vont être, à ce moment-là, 100% sécurisé. Bon, on repassera pour la vie sociale et le fait d'avoir un travail et de pouvoir se rendre à l'hôpital, mais les gens à l'intérieur ne pourront pas se plaindre, de toute façon, qui ont des problèmes de pouvoir se localiser. À l'époque, la problématique en était un de ce type de criminalité-là. On rencontrait, les gens avaient une inquiétude, les Canadiens avaient une inquiétude face aux crimes qui visaient leur résidence, leur demeure. Autre temps, autre mœurs. Maintenant, nous sommes confrontés aux cybermenaces, au sens large. 87% des maisons canadiennes sont connectées à Internet. Le commerce électronique au Canada est évalué en 2013 à 22,3 milliards de dollars. Donc, ce n'est pas juste une inquiétude d'un point de vue de sécurité publique ou de sécurité nationale. Mais il y a un impact économique réel. Il doit y avoir un sentiment de confiance pour que les utilisateurs, et je mentionne les utilisateurs au sens large, donc autant les commerçants que les individus qui vont sur la toile, se sentent dans un contexte de sécurité. L'accès, la disponibilité, la rapidité des échanges a fait en sorte qu'en parallèle aux usagers légitimes, s'est développé un monde virtuel où votre voisin peut télécharger un logiciel lui permettant accès aux caméras de vos ordinateurs, où des adolescents sont capables d'attaquer le réseau informatique d'une entreprise ou d'un individu, en prendre le contrôle et demander une rançon. un monde où des gens mal intentionnés vendent la propriété, les plans, les images des entreprises légitimes sans avoir d'inquiétude. Des organisations criminelles telles que Silk Road commettent des crimes, notamment au Canada, à la hauteur de 1,2 milliard de dollars US. Fermée par le FBI une première fois, la version 2 fut développée en partie à Toronto, au Canada. Sans parler des organisations terroristes qui recrutent, forment, planifient, financent et, dans certains cas, attaquent des systèmes informatiques pour voler de l'information. La liste ne pourrait être complète sans mentionner les problèmes sociaux, l'intimidation, l'harcèlement, les cyberprédateurs et j'en passe. Est-ce que la liste est complète? Non. Parce que les menaces évoluent au même rythme que la technologie. Les prochaines cibles, la voiture intelligente, les électroménagers, et oui, on fait même aujourd'hui des grilles pain connectées. Les réseaux industriels, les systèmes de distribution d'énergie, etc., etc., tout est aujourd'hui connecté. Pour vous donner une idée, les autorités américaines évaluent que nous aurons les premiers cas de hack des systèmes médicaux hospitaliers dans la prochaine année. Quelles sont les solutions? Il faut regarder des deux côtés de la machine, soit les systèmes et leurs composantes, et du côté des utilisateurs. Sur ce point, c'est ce qui m'amène à une de mes théories fétiches, soit celle dite de la vitre brisée. Le concept est simple et est utilisé en criminologie de façon assez courante. Si dans un environnement donné, on laisse un immeuble abandonné avec quelques vitres brisées, éventuellement des vandales en briseront d'autres, puis feront des graffitis, entreront dans l'immeuble, allumeront des feux et éventuellement de la consommation de drogue, du trafic et des crimes violents auront lieu sur le site. Pour prévenir cette situation, outre l'aspect policier qui ne peut régler seul la problématique, il est nécessaire que les résidents s'investissent pour avoir un sens de communauté et de confiance. C'est donc la communauté virtuelle du web qui doit s'investir et qui doit démontrer son appartenance en premier lieu. L'État, pour sa part, doit faire en sorte de faire évoluer les lois de façon exponentielle pour permettre d'appuyer cette démarche citoyenne, et par citoyen, j'inclus ici les entreprises et les organisations, l'ensemble des utilisateurs. À ce titre, je peux citer en exemple la loi récemment introduite par l'État de New York sur la cybersécurité des institutions financières, leurs affiliés et leurs fournisseurs, qui vient justement encadrer l'obligation pour ces organisations-là, parce qu'on reconnaît l'importance économique de ces participants-là à l'intérieur de l'État, au point de vue de leur utilisation et de leur dépendance des systèmes informatiques. Du côté criminel, la notion d'où est commis un crime doit être adaptée. Notamment le projet de loi, en exemple, le projet de loi S-220 contre la fraude internationale, présentement orphelin au Sénat, pourrait être un pas dans la bonne direction. Où se commet une infraction? La définition même de ce que nous avons dans le code criminel présentement n'est pas adaptée au développement que nous avons eu dans les dernières années au point de vue des technologies de l'information. Et on se retrouve dans des situations où les individus, notamment les pédophiles, vont se retrouver dans des pays, des endroits où ils peuvent partager librement de l'information. Ce n'est pas un crime partout sur la Terre. La fraude n'est pas considérée un crime. La fraude commerciale n'est pas considérée un crime dans plusieurs pays présentement. Donc, on se retrouve dans une situation où, malgré le fait que des Canadiens peuvent être impliqués ou que des Canadiens sont victimes, on ne peut pas exercer de recours en matière criminelle. Il y a des recours civils qui vont nous permettre d'accomplir une partie de la tâche. Et c'est généralement vers quoi, dans ma pratique, on va se tourner. Ces recours-là nous permettent de répondre à certaines situations, mais pas dans l'ensemble des cas. Et ça a un coût important. Donc, ce n'est pas à la portée de l'ensemble des citoyens canadiens. Du côté des systèmes, nous devons accepter qu'il n'y a pas de solution miracle. On n'a pas de moyens parfaits pour pouvoir prévenir et sécuriser les systèmes informatiques. tout système connecté, je reviens à mon exemple initial, de la maison en béton armé sans porte, sans fenêtre, on pourrait bâtir un ordinateur 100% sécuritaire. Il n'y aurait pas de clavier, il n'y aurait pas d'écran et il n'y aurait aucune connexion à aucun réseau. Donc, il ne servirait pas à grand-chose ultimement. Donc, on doit reconnaître qu'il y a un risque potentiel de placer, de se connecter et de rendre de l'information disponible. La facilité des transferts est une chose, mais devons-nous tout rendre disponible? Il faut aussi mettre en place certains standards pour éviter que le public soit berné par certains vendeurs de produits informatiques, de logiciels notamment, qui promettent un nombre incalculable de bénéfices sans nécessairement livrer. La France a pour sa part créé un organisme, une certification à cet égard, qui permet à sa population d'avoir un certain niveau de confiance quant à des produits ou des services qui leur sont offerts au niveau informatique. La protection des systèmes et des infrastructures informatiques doit être vue de façon globale et ne doit pas être limitée à des défenses de type ligne Maginot. Ou est-ce que, bon, on connaît le succès que la ligne Maginot a eu en France lors de la Deuxième Guerre mondiale, mais de nature adaptative et évolutive, donc ayant la capacité d'identifier qu'il y a une menace et permettre de la contenir, puis contre-attaquer et finalement enquêter pour amener les coupables devant les tribunaux, peu importe où soit-il. Et c'est essentiel d'assurer que l'ensemble des systèmes sont aussi protégés. Dans ma pratique, l'une des facettes, du moins de ma pratique, au Canada, dans des entreprises et des organisations, le taux de réussite, donc de pénétration des systèmes, avoisine le 90 %. Pas nécessairement en attaquant directement le système, mais en attaquant les individus, les utilisateurs, dans bien des cas, et souvent par des systèmes qui sont secondaires au réseau informatique principal. Fait que donc, il y a un niveau de vulnérabilité qui est existant ici au Canada, et on se préoccupe peu, bien souvent, malheureusement, ou pas dans les organisations de cette problématique-là, jusqu'à temps qu'il y arrive un incident. Et c'est vrai dans l'ensemble de la sécurité. On a modifié nos habitudes au point de vue de la sécurité dans les transports aériens suite aux événements du 11 septembre. C'est toujours, on est en réaction. Dans ce cas-ci, nous sommes à la pointe de développement technologique important. Et ce n'est que le début. Nous devons donc nous positionner pour protéger l'ensemble des citoyens canadiens. Il nous reste donc, basé sur cette statistique-là, et très humblement, on ne représente pas une immense partie du domaine canadien, mais si, à mon niveau, à moi, on se retrouve avec une statistique de cette importance, c'est qu'il nous reste énormément de travail à faire. Je vous remercie beaucoup.
Merci beaucoup, M. Sarrazin, pour cette présentation très intéressante. Alors, la troisième conférencière sera Bonnie Butlin. Bonnie est coordinatrice nationale de l'Alliance canadienne sur la cybersécurité et présidente du Conseil national. Elle est la cofondatrice et la directrice générale du Forum des partenaires en matière de sécurité. En outre, elle est la coordinatrice internationale de l'Alliance des femmes dans le secteur de la sécurité et de la résilience. Elle est également membre du conseil d'administration des rapports VIMI et vice-présidente de la collaboration publique-privée pour le partenariat en infrastructure de sécurité. Alors, Madame Butlin, bienvenue.
Good morning. Thank you all for having me here. It's a wonderful honor to be able to speak to you today. A more sophisticated and nuanced understanding of the Canadian cyber landscape is now required. It is exceptionally difficult for sectors individually, be it public, private, or not-for-profit, to fully understand and maximize the benefit of the cyber landscape while protecting the infrastructure, data, and citizens from threats. In order to gain an understanding of the state of cybersecurity in Canada and to build cybersecurity professional capacity, within Canada, the Canadian Cybersecurity Alliance, or CCA, was created. Founded by Grant Leckie, the CCA has brought together some 98 professional associations, with more anticipated to come on board in the coming weeks, with a stake in cybersecurity, within a truly agile and networked structure of inter-association engagement and knowledge sharing. Each of the 98 associations brings a unique professional perspective to cybersecurity. The associations often operated largely in isolation and unbeknownst to each other that they even existed. In combination, and with their perspectives layered upon each other, they provide an unparalleled contextualized understanding of the cyber landscape in Canada. The CCA has rapidly gained international recognition because of its uniqueness and its ability to collaborate, and its unprecedented scope, professional depth, and breadth across domains and disciplines related to cybersecurity. The CCA has been followed closely by our partner states, and the CCA has also been approached recently by a number of countries seeking to emulate the approach in their own areas of operation, including the UK, Australia, and India. Mapping and understanding Canadian capabilities is key to addressing the expanding cyber landscape and its growing importance for Canadians. This mapping has allowed the CCA to mesh together through the participation of 98 associations and unprecedented coverage of the entire Canadian cyber landscape in a way that has not been done to date. It's closing gaps, reinforcing seams through the collaboration, and identifying our unique strengths both geographically and conceptually in Canada. Complex threats are working together and are engaging us asymmetrically to our disadvantage. Through the emerging complex and comprehensive collaboration that the CCA enables, we may actually be able to respond in similarly complex fashion symmetrically, crowd out threats from the Canadian space, potentially operate at a higher level of collaboration that some threats would not be able to operate at. And there is also the potential that the CCA may operate as a smart structure in line with a smart cities concept, with participant associations acting as sensors for pulling in information about threats, lessons learned, best practices, and also being able to earlier identify threats and trends. It has the potential to solve increasingly complex problems more efficiently and quickly than we are to date. The human element in cybersecurity has become increasingly important. Technological solutions, as my colleague has mentioned, is incredibly important and on the cusp of greater developments. Very important, but we also have to look at cultural change and how we look at cyberspace and cyber issues. Cyber is no longer an emerging issue. We've gone in conferences from having a cyber track to or a cyber panel to a cyber track to having a full cyber conference in many cases. But it's now part of our daily lives. It's part of our homes, our work, our children are using the technology, and it has benefits and vulnerabilities. Leadership is required to optimize our interactions within the cyber landscape and requires an enhanced understanding of that landscape and openness to new perspectives. The CCA, by engaging so many different professional associations with different perspectives, is assisting in that manner. Technology itself is also driving the need to broaden participation and the scope of the discussions and become more inclusive. For example, big data and data analytics requires an interdisciplinary approach. These problems are becoming much larger. What originally started as a computer scientist and engineering problem now involves statisticians, probability scientists, and experts in specific fields, including subject matters. Medicine is highly involved in the area for cancer research and other. There are some interesting developments with Columbia University and their new Data Science Institute. MIT has an interesting program working on interdisciplinary results in data science and analytics. And Russia actually has an interesting center, Inopolis. The inclusion of a multidisciplinary perspectives and voices within the cyber landscape is critical for achieving the long-run balance and sustainability of cyber strategies that have proven so challenging post-9/11 and post-Snowden experience. We need to come up with a cyber strategy that is palatable for democratic societies, and this kind of inclusive discussion taking in considerations of privacy, legitimacy, rights, but also security issues is a mix that we're going to have to get right. We're also bringing in to the discussion groups that didn't previously have cyber in their business lines, facility security, education, fraud examination, mining in the energy sectors. Cyber has now become important to their business lines in a way that it hasn't been in the past. It's also an interesting move towards innovation. This type of professional crowdsourcing at a higher level for faster problem solving with deeper contextualization is much needed within the space. Ultimately, the CCA is a human network, and we've been very fortunate to have some wonderful people working with us. The National Council is made up of subject matter experts and distinguished personnel within the Canadian landscape, community builders in their own right. And we have tremendous talent that we found across the country, across demographics, geography, and across the many domains and disciplines of security. So with that, I'll leave that open to your questions and hand it over.
Well, thank you. You've really got your hands full. It sounds like this is a job you have that's been growing, so many different aspects of it that you've outlined. So I appreciate your comments. I think also, as I get to our last speaker, and also in follow-up questions, we sitting in the federal parliament, also want to know, you know, what should this institution, the Senate, the House of Commons, be doing in terms of these matters? So give some further thought to that. And our last panelist today is Peter Slowly, who I've known for a number of years because of the great service he has provided in past Toronto Police Services. He's until recently was a deputy chief of the Toronto Police Department. But he comes here today as the executive director with Deloitte Canada, working in the cyber section of the Risk Advisory Services, leading Deloitte's national security and justice industry practice to help modernize and optimize police, courts, corrections, national security, transportation-related organizations. He's a member of the National Cyber Crime Advisory Council for the Canadian Advanced Technology Alliance. Peter Slowly.
Thank you very much, Senator, appreciate the opportunity to be here today. Probably the most important part of my bio wasn't mentioned there. I'm the father of a 2-year-old and a 10-year-old child, and therefore there's a fierce urgency around getting this right for me. I want to touch on a couple of things that the previous speakers talked about. You obviously brought three amazing people in here. I'll try to add a little bit of value to what they've already done. I like the idea of this networking and asymmetric connections between levels. Commerce, democracy, human rights, privacy, crime, war, and terror are all now interconnecting on cyber platforms and in the real world in ways that we've never seen before. It is creating huge opportunities on the good side, democracy and commerce, and it is creating huge complexities in the threat environment that we've never seen before. I also want to be very clear, my comments will be focused mainly on policing and its role in this, although I don't believe at all, that David talked about, that this is the primary source of security for any democratic nation. And I want to be clear, I'm talking about policing, not law enforcement. I think it's a terrible thing when any document says that law enforcement, describing an agency or an entity. There is no such thing as law enforcement as an entity. It is a practice within policing and within security. Policing in its totality requires prevention at the very first, engagement always, and the protection and promotion of rights as the core output of its services. When we reduce policing or any other organization to the term law enforcement, the only thing you get is an enforcement solution to very complex problems. With that, I have a number of points to cover off, and hopefully I can get them in before the gavel comes down. Very quickly, the first 4 points are at a very general level. The rate and nature of change requires an evergreen cyber strategy. There's no point having one in 2010 and updating it in 2014, or having one in 2016 and then updating it 4 years later around an election cycle. Moore's Law says that technology doubles every 2 years. I suggest that at the very minimum, your cyber strategy has to keep pace with that. There's a great saying out of the UK cyber strategy, you must run fast in order to even stand still in the new change environment. There needs to be some sort of an appointment at the federal level, but I think it needs to be replicated at the provincial and municipal levels, a cyber czar to overarch ministries and associate and other levels of divisions of government in order to coordinate and develop a level of cyber capacity and update the strategy on a continual basis. I think at the federal level, there needs to be some sort of a concept of a cyber ambassador. Again, beyond the traditional ambassadorial role, this is someone who is working with the international trade associations, international organizations like the UN, OSCE, and focusing on developing a new system of MLATs and trade agreements that allow for us to get into the server farm issue. It's not a cloud, it's a physical piece of geography where servers exist. And if you can't access those places, there's no point conducting investigations or defensive operations. Third point, there needs to be a new concept around P5 partnerships. I put police at the front end, that's just a default for me, but we're talking about the private sector, the broader public sector, the privacy commissions, and I separate them out specifically, and public education, both at the post-secondary and at the elementary levels. These need to now integrate at the strategy level, operational level, and tactical level for both prevention and response operations. If you don't have those five entities working together at the start of a design of a plan, at the strategy, operational, and tactical level, and then in the implementation of those operations, I don't think we're going to get to the full level that we need. I believe that relates somewhat, Bonnie, to your point around creating a symmetrical response to of a networked strategy as opposed to the asymmetrical threats that we're facing. Number four, we need to increase investment significantly and use innovative strategies to accelerate Canada's cybersecurity capacity. You need to leverage the amazing diaspora that relates to Canada. We have one of the most diverse nations in the world. The diaspora creates a multiplier effect if we're able to tap into them more strategically, and particularly as it relates to cyber. The UK is spent in 2011 £900 million on its cyber strategy. We spent $90 million. That's a factor of 10. They've just announced in their 2016 strategy that they're doubling their financial investment to £1.9 billion. We are still at $90 million, unless someone can inform me of a new level of investment. So you need an HR strategy to address this IT challenge, and you need a new financial strategy to address the investments needed to keep pace. I'm going to suggest that the use of social investment bonds might be a way to look at that. Deloitte has sponsored some papers on SIBs and be happy to share that later on. Now into the policing realm. Prevention must be the prime focus of any cybersecurity strategy. We must be secure, vigilant, and resilient. And ultimately, you can't have 100% security. But vigilance and resilience start and end, in my humble opinion, with prevention. We can't arrest our way out of this problem. The problem with the broken windows theory in New York City is that they focused on enforcement as a solution to a human nature issue, as opposed to prevention. They overinvested in enforcement and actually turned their communities against their police. So 53% of all crimes in the UK have now been tracked back to some cyber element. Instead of calling it a cyber crime, the UK is now just calling it core crime, and therefore core policing requires that every element of policing has an element of cyber in it, and again, focusing more on the prevention than on the enforcement end. Despite the fact that 53% of all UK crimes have a cyber element, only 50 cases, 50, ended up through a successful prosecution in court. Number six, my next point is the offender, number one victim, and number one offender is us. We do it deliberately or we're duped by actions of others, social engineering, et cetera, et cetera. If you're going to start at prevention, then you need to have both a carrot and stick approach. Gamify this approach to public engagement, public awareness. That certainly will help with the new millennials who are going to at some point be taking over the organizations that we all now run. And also, you've got to scare to care. Unfortunately, I don't think people understand the full depth of the threat, and therefore we need to raise a level of awareness in order to get them to do the normal hygiene things like brushing your teeth twice a day and changing your password account once a week. Australia has an amazing process called Cyber Smart Nation. I would point Canadians in that direction to look at that, particularly around how do we make us more part of the solution. Number seven. Police and national security agencies must have a high capacity for both defense and offense. Certainly, we need to go after offenders. We need to be able to create some sort of a threat to the offender that they're going to be investigated successfully and, more importantly, prosecuted, and that there'll be some material consequences for their actions. This is very critical, I think, for the public sector and government. Private sector have right now, and I believe in the future, far more capability to go on offense. Defense, we need to mitigate against the loss of private sector in order to build confidence in the economy. There needs to be cyber training at all levels, starting in junior kindergarten and senior kindergarten, right the way to police academies and police colleges, and into the private sector training and development programs. And at the core of everything, there needs to be a privacy approach and a rights-based approach in almost everything we design. Number eight, and I'll conclude my comments very quickly at that point, regulation and standards. It was referenced that we're reviewing Bill C-51, mandatory public reporting around privacy breaches and IT security breaches. There needs to be some more confident way for them, easy way for people to report their victimization to the police. If we can't track the level of victimization, we'll never understand the scale of the problem. That information needs to be privatized and anonymized at the highest level and turned over to eight entities like Bonnie referenced for us to do big data analysis to get a real sense of where the problems are coming from and where the potential solutions are. We need to be able to investigate and prosecute as required, and particularly when requested. We simply can't, as a police entity, respond to any member of the public, any small, medium, or large private sector enterprise, that we don't have the capacity to do that. No one could walk into a police station in Fredericton or in Vancouver or in Toronto and say, my son or daughter is being victimized online in the schoolyard, or my small business that has two employees and a net profit at the end of the week of a couple hundred dollars has been defrauded. And the response from the local police is, we don't know how to solve your problem. That's not our job to solve your problem. There has to be, at a minimum level, for that level of Canadian a response with the police, and that response has to be integrated into a larger ecosystem. I conclude my comments. Happy to answer any questions.
Well, there's a basket full of ideas. There may be some things that panelists said that other panelists may want to pick up on, and as we get into the questions and the dialogue, that would be the opportunity. Meanwhile, we need to get people who want to ask. I've got a couple of senators down already. Anybody else want to get on the list? Just let us know. Okay, Senator Joyeux. And again, I remind those in the seats in front of me that Mike and Agnes will take your name down if you want to ask a question or make a comment at microphone 5 at some point.
Hello. First question that I have on the list here is Senator Munson, and followed by Senator Massicott.
Thank you, chairs, and thank you for being here this morning. I have two questions. The first one is short to Mr. Slowly. Cyber czar, cyber ambassador, and you talked about the money being spent in the UK comparison to here. How much authority, what kind of, as a cyber czar, would it be a separate ministry? Would it be working as a security advisor to the prime minister? How could you just elaborate on that for me? I think it's a fascinating proposal.
Thank you for the question, Senator Munson. First, I would challenge not to rely on any of the usual structures that we would default to. However, being as limited as most in the room are at conceiving of new structures, I would suggest that it would be set up somewhat similar to a direct security advisor to the PMO or something out of the Privy Council, potentially. I don't claim to know all the structures that exist at the federal level. I have some greater understanding of structures that exist at the provincial level, and I've seen some interesting examples where you have a justice minister, for instance, in Saskatchewan, Deputy Minister Dale McPhee, a former police chief in Prince Albert, who is now leading a transformation of all the human sector ministries within Saskatchewan, but bringing both a security and a health lens to how that works. And through big data analytics is actually able to identify some real core causes and core solutions that are saving taxpayers potentially hundreds of millions of dollars. I think a similar type of innovation and arrangement could produce not only a greater level of security, but ultimately save us from spending bad money and save good money that's being spent in less efficient ways right now.
Thank you. I just want to follow on another question. I know others here, specifically Senator Kenney, who's done a lot of work formerly with his defense committee on cyber issues some time ago, and there are recommendations in the Defense and Security Committee some time ago of what governments should do. This summer, I was at a conference in Chicago and once again met Ted Koppel, who I know from my old days in the news business. And as you folks probably know and maybe have read his book, Lights Out, A Nation Unprepared, it's a bestseller investigating book on the power grid in the United States of America, where he talks about the United States being shockingly unprepared, particularly the vulnerability of transformers. And some have criticized the book as being a bit overreaching and scary and lights out, meaning lights out, because as you've talked about this morning, everything is interconnected, particularly hydro lines, and particularly Canada and the United States and hydro lines. and nobody is really, from his perspective, is taking a serious look at a cyber attack striking at the core of the United States. So if his equation is the United States is unprepared, is Canada unprepared? And anybody can answer this question.
I will ask any of the panelists who want to get in on that question and your previous question that Mr. Slowly answered. I'll start over here with Professor Murakami Wood.
Hi, I'll just come back on that suggestion. I think you're right that we should be relying on different structures. One of the problems with creating ministries, of course, is they create their own bureaucratic institutional norms, and then it's very difficult to get them to change later. The only good thing about ministries is they have formal accountability. And one of the issues, I generally agree with your approach, one of the issues is how those kinds of advisors, special advisors, czars, and so on, are held accountable for what they do. And I think that has to be taken into account as well. So that I agree with you, but we need to have mechanisms also of accountability. On the other question, this is a really key one, right? Because the threat of attacks to power grids is often one of the major justifications for extensions of national powers of cybersecurity. It's a major concern in the USA. I wouldn't say it's underestimated. In fact, I would say the opposite. It's one of the massive concerns of the CIA and the NSA right now. In fact, to the extent that they took the brownout that occurred in the 1990s, the famous Northeast brownout, as being a kind of a guide to the future of what could happen with a cyber attack. The biggest problem in the USA is that the actual networks themselves are old and falling apart. It's not that they're especially a problem for cybersecurity. It's a problem just for infrastructure renewal, like most U.S. problems. I mean, U.S. infrastructure, as we all know, is falling apart in a way that makes Canada look relatively okay. We shouldn't be complacent, however. We know the situation in Montreal, right? Bridges are falling apart. And in fact, just because we can see things like bridges falling apart, we should be aware that things like electricity infrastructure are equally old and outdated and need constant renewal. I would say, though, it's not fundamentally a cybersecurity issue. It's more of an issue of infrastructure renewal more generally, of which cybersecurity is just one of the things one needs to consider. If one puts it forward primarily as a cybersecurity issue, then you get cybersecurity sorts of solutions, and that's not really what the only kind of question we need to consider when it comes to infrastructure, I would say. It's important, but it tends to skew investment priorities a little too much, I would say. That's my answer.
Anybody else want to get in on this?
Yeah.
Yes, says that.
As far as infrastructure security in Canada, it's something that is looked into. It is something that is followed upon. But keep in mind that a cyber attack on such infrastructure, you're still looking at thousands of kilometers of lines in unoccupied territories that are vulnerable to a stick of dynamite, basically. So, and I've spent literally thousands of hours working on this, there is no perfect solution to answer that issue. There is no way we can actually guarantee 100% security to these infrastructures. The U.S. is in the same position. Yes, we can work as much as we can to try and prevent gaining access to the systems, but even more important is the detection of these attempts to try and connect with these systems. We know that foreign entities have mapped out the U.S. infrastructure system. That's a known fact, and that was presented before Congress. So there is a reality there, but where can we go and how far we can go is another matter.
Yes, I'd like to take a shot at this question. We are not prepared right now in Canada, but we're getting prepared. Through the CCA, we have already started discussions with the mining sector, the gas and petroleum sector, the electricity related associations as well. And conversations are already taking place across the country at this time on how different associations, different perspectives can start working on control systems and their protection. We are currently engaged in an activity that's looking at the connection between emergency management and cybersecurity. We're working on a number of different areas as well, starting those conversations, getting groups together to discuss, which isn't always easy. In the private sector, different companies have intellectual property concerns. They have different proprietary reasons for not discussing too much, but we are noting that there's a turning point now, that there is a common need and a recognition that it's in everybody's interest to have these discussions on a security level.
Mr. Sloan?
Just a very brief addition. The concept of cyber versus physical security, this is not a binary issue. This is a singular issue. And again, although I've said, you know, a cyber czar, really we're talking about a security czar, someone who can secure our national infrastructure at the physical level and at the cyber level. And I think that it's very important that the conversation stop being, well, we've taken care of the physical side, we're good there. Now let's just focus on the cyber side. And maybe we can draw some resources away from physical over to cyber. This is a singular new normal where cyber and physical operate real time in every space. Right now there are people focusing on the physical environment here and engaging physically at the same time. They're operating on one or more digital platforms in this room right now with both sets of issues. And that's the way we have to focus going forward.
Okay, Senator Massicott.
Thank you. Thank you for all four of you for being here. It's very interesting. Obviously, as human beings, we always try, we exaggerate our fears because we're always worried of things we don't know. And I'm just trying to check my own fear. I worry a lot about this issue. I read about UCOs, that you look at American department stores. All kinds of people are losing confidential information, which I've trusted them with. But what is real? Mr. Saraza, you actually work in these cases. Mr. Sleffy also. Is it happening? I mean, I don't know any of my friends who lost property because of breaks. And, yeah, we read about it all the time. It looks like they got a lot of information, but I don't hear of the consequences where somebody took, you know, $50,000 for their bank account. So just put it in perspective. What is really happening? I know we're all worried about this thing, but what is really happening today? And then reassure me. If we spent the efforts, I say, if I give my confidential information to Bell or Telus and they don't take the measures to protect it, they lose my account immediately. And once it gets publicized, a lot of people worry about it and they'll switch again. Is that motivation enough? Are they doing their job?
It's a complex question. Not sure I'm going to reassure you, by the way.
Stick with the facts.
Absolutely. Statement of fact, yes, it is happening. Yes, there are cases, people out there are, you know, mal, avec des mauvaises intentions, mm-hmm. are looking into obtaining information. You might not feel the pain of this because your bank will change your credit card number, your information. Those who do, although, have got a serious issue. One of our collaborators, who's a forensic crime expert, got his identity stolen 3 years ago. He's identified the people. This is his job. And they've taken over his account. Now, he's gone, and Peter mentioned this, he's gone to the police, and they're basically saying, well, there's nothing we can do. He's gone to everyone he can go to. He's gone to his banks. He's gone to the credit companies. He's gone everywhere because it's blocking him in all of his life. Basically, when he wants to buy something, when he deposits a check in his own personal account, people have been using his identity. But we're going, and in this case, we're going away from cybercrime because then it becomes fraud and it becomes something else. That's why, and again, I agree with Peter, he was saying a lot of good things, that it's a unified approach that we need. It's not just a cyber problem. It's a general criminality problem that we're addressing at this point. And this is basic fraud. You know, basically right now, if you do $1,500 of fraud per day through internet, through the stealing of identities through the web, nobody will investigate you in Canada. And you can keep on going. You pick your victims out of Canada and you do your transactions here locally, nobody's gonna care. And this is what actually happens. So, and you're making quite a bit of money there.
So are they doing enough? Is Bell doing enough? How about the CIBC? How about Royal Bank?
Everybody is doing, you know, to the extent they're investing massively. The big organizations are in there. The banks are in there. There's always a possibility of doing more. You know, the government could do more. Everybody could do more. Now, it's a question of having, is it where we want to invest? Is it the place where we want to be putting our money? Is it our top priority? No, because obviously the private enterprise, their top priority is selling their product or selling their services. It's not their main goal. Everybody has their own priorities. So we have to bring it forward. And again, when we talk about security, whatever type of security we're talking about, whether it be physical or, you know, cyber, we're always, you know, not necessarily the fun guys to speak with. You know, we're not going to show a profit at the end of the line. And you can't, exactly. And you can't show, you know, this is the money you save because we put in a new law or we spent $100 million more on this type of security. We prevented something from happening. It doesn't show up that way.
But how about the Canadian banking system? Has anybody stolen money from CIBC, Royal Bank, or whatever? Has any been crashed?
Banks.
How about the blackmail, the malpractice issue?
All of these things are happening. It is a reality. Yes, banks are being victimized through different types of frauds and systems. It's not necessarily simply cybercrime. There are different issues. There was a series of frauds last week in Europe. In about 24 hours, they got away with about $10 million due to a glitch in the instant teller machines.
The Swift.
That's another one. Yeah. But yeah, exactly. That's over $100 million. Yeah. So the Swift transfer system fraud a few months ago. But last week it was instant teller machines where the code was modified and they found a loophole. They were emptying out 250,000 euros per machine in about 10 minutes. So only using a smartphone. So technology is nice, you know, I agree with that. But the thing is that, well, I'm a low-tech guy, as you can see. There are some limits to where you can go. And yes, you need to be worried. Everybody needs to be worried. You need to be careful. You know, the power in a relationship, I've been married for quite a while, the power in a relationship relies with the person, not with the person that says yes. It relies with the person who says no. That's where the real power resides. On the web and in any form of computer, that's where your power lies. You know, you can accept. We actually track back hackers using our own proprietary tools. And we basically send them emails. And most often than not, they will actually open up the email and read through it and get infected by what we're using to track them back. So it's, you know, it's one way of doing it. But I mean, that's the reality where it is right now. Even these guys have got their own failures. But we have to look into that. That's the way, and you've got to be careful. That's the only way to do it.
Anybody else want to pick up on this, Professor?
Just briefly, one of my colleagues, Kevin Haggerty, did some interesting research on identity fraud a few years ago. And one thing he uncovered was that, you know, American Express had done their own research and argued that 75% of identity fraud was inside jobs, i.e. humans inside financial organizations doing these things, basically. It's not necessarily about cybersecurity, again. It's about fraud. It's about individuals and behavior. And many of the solutions are conventional in that sense. But also they're internal, so organizations don't like to talk about this, right? They don't like to admit that their organizations are vulnerable, that their people are not trustworthy in that sense, or are the same as every other human being in the world, basically. And that's one of the biggest problems, too, I think.
So is it real, Senator Massicott? We have children across this country who are committing suicide because they're being bullied online. And when they go for help, the police are not able to address them. Some of the most high-profile cases from the East Coast to the West Coast. We have small, medium, and large businesses who are being victimized on a daily basis at a scale of billions of dollars. Most of it isn't reported for the same reasons you don't want to lose confidence in those same businesses. We have universities with their IP and their intellectual capital being siphoned off, in some cases state-sponsored, in other cases just to make $30,000 to blow in a weekend party. We have police services in this country and south of the border who have been themselves been attacked on ransomware, and again, not being publicly reported. There are military-grade operations by terrorist organizations and state organizations where cyber is at the heart of it. ISIS is successful because they've taken the cyber game to a whole new level. that the international community can't compete against. So is there a real and present danger? Absolutely there is. Now, is it greater than the danger to our economy, as fragile as it is? Is it greater to the danger of our environment, as fragile as it is? Is it greater than the danger of our health? It's relative. And so we're not saying spend every dollar you can on this issue. But when you're looking at the scarce dollars to spend, make sure that you at least appropriate the size of the challenge, and it is a real size. I also believe there's enough money in the system. We're not spending the money effectively. We're spending too much at the wrong end of the scale, particularly when it comes to policing, in the enforcement end, and not enough at the prevention end. That reduces the cost of policing. Those dollars can then be reinvested into any of those other areas, environmental health or national cyber strategy. The white market is big, the black market is bigger, and the dark market will eclipse them all. So that's a global economical issue. It's going to have to be confronted. Ultimately, what is the main reason for a national government? To protect its citizens and to create an environment where rights are promoted and protected. If you can't protect against cyber, you can't protect against privacy, and privacy will trump human rights in this century. And so again, there's another issue that the federal government has to focus on. It's at the core of protecting and protecting human rights and promoting economic sustainability.
Thank you.
Wow. Very good information. Senator Jane Gordy.
Thank you very much. This has been really fascinating. I'm just wondering, in light of Senator Massicott's question, how much international cooperation and coordination is there? Because so much crosses countries' lines. You know, you spoke earlier about bullying, and bullying used to be happening perhaps on the schoolyard or in the neighborhood. Now it can happen internationally. We heard of a case of someone allegedly encouraging somebody to commit suicide from outside the country. E-commerce, you know, this goes on. There are no boundaries defined, and somebody stealing an identification or getting into your privacy. So what are the challenges when you do have bullying from outside the country, or in the case of somebody allegedly encouraging suicide from outside the country, or e-commerce kinds of things? Our country's cooperating, and Mr. Slowly, you mentioned the czar who would work with other countries. So what kinds of things are happening now?
So very quickly, and I think there's other people more capable of responding. The one case you talked about related to a gentleman, I use that term very loosely, in the United States, who was contacting young people online and encouraging them to commit suicide and providing them with very detailed plans and customized plans. Ultimately, there was a successful investigation because we have a very strong set of agreements between the United States and Canada. Our MLATs are extremely secure. Relationships exist. And so we were able to conduct an investigation on foreign soil and actually get a successful prosecution, ultimately, with that relationship. But shift that over to pick country X or Y or Z, where we don't have those same strong relationships, and it falls apart. The wonderful thing about policing in the old days, if we seized your computer, your laptop, or your device, we could get into some portion of the hardware and secure the majority of the information that we needed. And almost within the next few years, every sophisticated criminal organization doesn't have hardware. It's in the cloud. It's in servers. And they're all in places where they're committing the crime. There isn't a mutual agreement in the country where the servers exist. And so the FBI has come running up into that with spectacular results. So there's no easy answer, but until we really expand and intensify our approach to developing those multinational agreements and specific MLATs with as many countries as we can around the ability for us to defend and investigate, then we're going to be forever behind the game. It'll take a long time to do, but we might as well get going on it.
Anybody else?
I would like to take this one. The Canadian Cybersecurity Alliance is focused within Canadian space. Behind that, there is the Security Partners Forum, which has gone international and is focused on security issues beyond cybersecurity-related issues. So while we work with some 98 associations in Canada on cybersecurity, we also work with some 600 to 700 professional associations globally, and we work on every continent, including Antarctica. You'd be surprised how many scientific stations and cruise ships go down there who require security personnel to be engaged as well. Also with SECRA, the Women in Security and Resilience Alliance, which I'm the international coordinator for, we started this in 2015, and since then we have 35 women in security organizations internationally who have joined together, which is another window into what is happening in different parts of the world. The associations are interesting because the personnel cross over into private sector, they cross over into public sector and other facets of those countries. It's giving an incredible look into what is happening globally and allowing personnel in different countries to cooperate and share knowledge and information in a very real way on a whole range of security issues, cyber and the full range of other issues that we need to tackle. So while government and the international agreements are really important and those relationships are incredibly beneficial, there is also another network that's developing and is doing a lot of good right now.
Peter, David?
Go ahead, David.
I just want to say something about the fact that, I mean, you mentioned the dark web earlier on, and it's, you know, this going back to this question of fear, I'm not an expert on child safety, so I really don't want to comment on that specific thing apart from to say that I share your distress, and we all do, I think. As a sociologist, one of the things I think is worth pointing out is that the dark web itself is not necessarily the threat that we think it is entirely. It's undoubtedly there are bad people operating on the dark web, but a lot of what goes on there is actually perfectly ordinary things. It's not actually quite as exciting as you think it is necessarily most of the time. But also, there's actually innovation going on there. And it seems like a strange thing to say, but where did Bitcoin come from? Bitcoin is basically a system that people regard as being this really spooky, strange thing, this currency that didn't exist. It came out of sort of dark web practices. And funnily enough, through law enforcement operations, the FBI now holds a significant amount of Bitcoin because it seized a fair amount. The FBI now guarantees the value of Bitcoin globally as a result. This is actually creating a new system of recognized monetary value. Blockchain, on which the technology on which Bitcoin is based, which again came out of dark web operations, is actually now being looked at by major corporations and by government as a way of ensuring security of financial transactions online in a different kind of way through openness and kind of shared openness and transparent sort of database, which is how it basically works. It's both encrypted but open in some ways. So what I would say is don't think that the answer is to shut down things that are not official, that are, you know, dark webs and so on. A lot of innovative things happen which are actually, probably in the longer term, will transform the way we do everything. That doesn't mean you can just say let everything happen on the dark web and see what happens. That's not the message. But just to say it's not all terrible. It's not actually all illegal and even, and it's certainly not all bad in terms of what the outcomes could be.
Oui. Merci. I'll borrow your... Thanks,
you
David. Yeah, exactly. To answer your question, victimization is a major issue. As far as all the crimes concerning children, it's been a major, major target of law enforcement. We see it indirectly through my practice during investigations internally in corporations or organizations, but we automatically need to turn it over to law enforcement. So that goes on in a different way. As far as companies being victims directly of the malicious intent, usually there's a part that is cyber, and again, there's a part that is human. And often enough, it can be an employee who's not happy with his job. It could be an employee that is going to a competitor. It could be an employee who has an allegiance to a foreign entity or to an organization, a terrorist organization. It happens in a lot of different ways. Now, once we see that, we start working. And I've worked with a lot of different countries in different statuses. If I'm working, for instance, for the UN, where the International Penal Tribunal gives us extraordinary power. This is, law enforcement times 10. Because you can go to any signatory country and obtain search warrants for any type of information you're looking for. So that facilitates a lot of things. In my normal practice, usually when we talk to people down the line that are, when we ask for assistance, because we can't officially order them to assist us, but we can actually ask them for it, and we can talk with people locally in Switzerland, we've gotten fantastic results. And one of the interesting things Switzerland has done is that they consider that if you see something on your screen, on your computer screen, the crime is committed in Switzerland. Whether or not the server is in Switzerland doesn't matter to Swiss law. So that's a very interesting point of view. And that helps greatly when you're doing investigations in these countries. We'll work with in Germany. We've worked with a lot of countries in South America. So, and these, the people will usually rally if they see that somebody's doing something. They will come to your assistance. They will give you. I've communicated with law enforcement agencies in the U.S. and asked a sheriff department in Arizona to get a statement from one of his residents, basically because I needed to have a statement from the victim, per se, of a crime. And I'm not an official organization. So, and he said, I'll do it. What are you going to do with the information once I send it to you? Well, we're going to court with it. We're going to press charges against these guys. Perfect. I'll assist you. We'll go. We'll get a statement. He got it off to me. That's the kind of assistance you get if you talk to the right people. And but generally, most people are interested.
I said I wasn't an expert on child abuse, and I'm not. But there was one thing I wanted to mention. The first thing, the thing I wanted to mention is that there's a myth that child abuse is more prevalent now than it used to be. It's not true. Just think of the networks of what we now call paedophiles that used to be users of child prostitution in the old days, of course, have existed for a very long time. They collaborated in dark, literally in dark corners and in the edges of you know, civilization in various ways. In some ways, the existence of connectivity and information systems has allowed us to find people like this that we would not have been able to find before. So in some ways, it's not necessarily, again, that we as a new threat because of the internet. There's actually a new opportunity to find people who would not have otherwise been connected, and we can now actually get the people that we were unable to find before in these ways. They're not now necessarily haunting the edges of fairgrounds looking for children, which is actually, by the way, one of the biggest things that used to exist in the 19th century around child prostitution and things. But they're now on the internet, and we can find them.
I do feel the need to challenge back a little bit. And David, you and I agree amazingly, so many levels. The difference between the fairground exercise of the 18th century and what happens now is that that child is victimized, sodomized, victimized in some way in that physical moment. And it haunts them for the rest of their lives, and hopefully they're never again victimized in that same way. Problem now is images are collected from that. They're shared globally. And that person is re-victimized every single time someone sees their image on a screen. And depending on how far that image goes, it can then affect their work opportunities and their life opportunities, their ability to meet and marry somebody because they have to disclose this to their husband or their spouse.
Yeah, absolutely.
So the level of victimization has exponentially increased.
It's different. Absolutely.
And
it's changed.
You could take that example from the child abuse into economic structures. The level of access, once you've accessed an individual physically or online, and you have digital information, you can continue to re-victimize that person, that organization, that society over and over again.
Mm-hmm. I absolutely agree. I think that's true. And I think there's other kinds of considerations here. I think it relates to other issues like the right to be forgotten, which is something that's now being a big subject of contention between the US and Europe, for example. But yes, I absolutely agree. But at the same time, it does give us methods and new ways of finding people we would have been unable to find before. But I completely agree.
Merci, Madame la Présidente. I would like to ask for you, from your own standpoint of your own practice, is the legal framework in Canada sufficient to address the context, I should say, nightmarish that you have described in your own presentation? In other words, is the legislation, is Canada up to date, or are we trailing back, or is it how you see it as an obstacle to efficient, I should say, answer to what we see as coming up, not only from individual company, but from countries. As you know, China is doing that. Russia is doing it with the election, the American election those days, helping the candidate, you know, that opposed Madame Clinton. I think that internationally there is not really the capacity to really address that context, that international context. In other words, I am not aware that there is any international convention that would facilitate outside the Five Eyes, you know, that include Canada, Britain, Australia, and so on, and United States, that we're still the infancy of recognizing the impact that it has and on the capacity of the country to protect their own citizens and protect their own existence.
Short answer to the question, are we prepared and ready now with a regulatory and legislative framework? No. Slightly longer answer, we've made significant strides in a relatively short period of time. Some promising things, the requirement for disclosure to stakeholders and shareholders when there's been a breach, I think is a significant step in the right direction. Still needs some work. I think our privacy legislation is very, very strong, and I would suggest that's actually a better place to start from than a Bill C-51. Having privacy, not just by design and all the ways we've talked about, but privacy as a priority at national, provincial, and I would suggest even municipal levels will help to drive a lot of good bylaw, provincial legislation, and federal legislation. So then when we get to it, we'll have more resilient and sustainable legislation around which to build. I think there are other countries, Australia particularly, who are leading the UK, who are leading on creating new legislation or strengthening existing regulation. Mm-hmm. And there are some exciting discussions I'm hearing now as I'm part of the private sector and working in a company like Deloitte around current standards and standards that are being created every day. I think standards creation can probably do more to secure what we're talking about than government legislation. And so, again, I think it's not just a one-size-fits-all. Government needs to move as fast as it can and faster than it has been, but it can also work with private sector and other public sector to create standards, industry standards, that can supplement and support and work in a complementary way going forward. Mm-hmm.
I am aware of a number of discussions happening within the Canadian legal community right now. There weren't cyber courses within law schools until recently. Cyber expertise was not common in law firms until quite recently as well. And that community, like many other, the medical community, the engineering community, and others, are still grappling with how does this affect their practice? How does this affect privacy and issues with their clients? What does it mean in terms of international relationships and agreements and transfer of information and compatibility with other laws on cyber in other states? And so these discussions are going on, and we're not there yet, but we are trying. And sometimes it is a bit of a step forward and a step back. The Canadian anti-spam legislation, CASEL, I've done quite a bit of work on this as well in terms of what CASEL has done to the not-for-profit sector. It's been exceptionally hard on the not-for-profit sector, and because it was applied to individuals and not-for-profits in a way that did not occur under PIPEDA and still does not occur in many other states. And so what was well-intentioned is actually having a chilling effect on collaborations and discussions and activities that really have nothing to do with spamming. So there are some growing pains. The legislation that is coming in is doing some good, but there are wrinkles. But the legal community itself is not unlike other communities where they too are trying to grapple with what does this mean for our businesses and our daily lives.
Mm-hmm. Okay. One of my points in my presentation was orphan bill S-220, that is before the Senate at this point. That's a good example of the type of law that we need to bring into practice certain aspects of the criminal code that can be better suited to answer certain types of cybercrime and fraud, because inevitably you cross over from the cyber side to the physical side at one point or another. As far as government-sponsored intelligence and coin operations or counterintelligence, at that point we always have the issue that within the originating country, it's considered legal. So nobody's committing an infraction at that point. But physical intelligence gathering operations are in the same way. And there are a lot of different means that are used nowadays, not only, you know, through cyber, but through actual meetings and one-on-ones. It's still an ongoing process for a lot of different countries. Mm-hmm. Canada does it, and most of our partner countries do it all as well. So we're a victim, but we're also involved. So that's at another level, mm-hmm. and it's not in the same category. Of course, you know, the organizations and the companies involved in Canada need to be secured and need to shift their protection towards these possible threats. But that's one threat among so many others. As far as the obligation to declare when a breach has occurred, in some cases that puts a lot of pressure on the actual investigation process, and that can become in certain cases problematic for us. It also can disclose certain security risks for the organizations that are obliged to disclose. So we've got to be very careful as far as that's concerned. Mm-hmm. I know that it's a tempting way of doing things, and I know the U.S. has done it. They've brought in modifications along the way, but it's still something that needs to be looked at globally and not just on the specific aspect mm-hmm. of the possible hack or possible loss of information. So we've got to be very careful about that, because it can show the way for others also. And it's very difficult in a 60-day period to be able to investigate and correct at the same time a possible weakness in a security system. So we have to keep in mind that ideally we want to correct the situation, but we also want to find out who did it and why.
Okay. At the risk of getting into a whole new discussion about international politics and the role of the Five Eyes, my PhD, by the way, was on the National Security Agency back in the early 2000s, before all the current concern. At the risk of getting into a huge new discussion, the one thing I will say is that bear in mind that the Five Eyes may be part of the problem, not necessarily part of the solution. And I'd ask you to think about this by stepping outside of your role as Canadian senators here and thinking geopolitically about this, and how countries who are not involved in the Five Eyes might feel about this organization and the threat that it poses to their national security. Now, if anybody thinks here that the USA does not involve itself in cyber attacks on Russia or China, and it's only a victim of terrible Russian hacking, you have another thing coming. The NSA is an active cyber war organization in that sense of the term. It uses the US Marine Corps' electronic warfare squadrons operate under the NSA. So, you know, this is not something the Russians do to us and we are the innocent victims of this. This is a classic case of, you know, international competition, all the usual sort of spy versus spy stuff. It's still going on. So just bear that in mind. If we want to actually think about cooperation on cybersecurity, we need to think about other forms of multilateral cooperation that are done through diplomatic channels, that are not necessarily done through security intelligence or, you know, organizations set up for Cold War purposes. That's one point. I think one of the other points is to bear in mind here is that I think I've lost what I was going to say now. I did have another point to make, but I'll if I think of it as the discussion goes on, then we'll carry on. There is another point.
Thank you.
Comments and or questions, and I apologize in advance for mispronunciation of names, but the first name I have is Anil Somalia, perhaps, from Carleton University. Microphone number 5.
Thank you. Associate Professor of Computer Science at Carleton. My area of research is computer security. And so what I just wanted to say to you all is, as someone who's been working for over 20 years in this area, we don't know what we're doing. I mean this in a very fundamental sense. I mean, it's easy to blame the victim, to say humans are making all these mistakes and using these computer systems that, oh, if you had just been more careful in choosing your password, you wouldn't have been compromised. But the fact is we built these systems originally as playthings. We were playing around in a nice, trusting environment, say, oh, look, we can make these computers talk to each other. And now all of a sudden, we have billions of computers talking to each other with almost everything of value that we have on them in an information sense. We didn't plan on this, and we're still trying to figure out what it all means. I mean, it's like putting electricity everywhere before we understood how to, you know, properly insulate things. All of a sudden, buildings burn down left and right when you turn on a light switch. That's where we are now with computer security. So the first thing in designing any policy, I would say, is to know that we're still figuring this out. I mean, there are people working on building codes for first computer security. We still don't know what those are. We don't know that we have technologies to secure things like cryptography that where you make one character mistake, all your protection goes away. I mean, what do we build with those kind of tolerances? Nothing. So, I mean, I would say, put money into research. You know, we should have designated money for cybersecurity research. But more importantly, we need to only trust the computers as far as we have to. Don't do what we potentially could do. Do what we need to do. And that's the best way to keep us safe. I mean, think twice. Like the cloud gives me nightmares. Because, and not to say that we can't do it, it's that the consequences of doing it are potentially so bad. I mean, one data center, one attacker, all gone. So.
Yes, well, thank you. We'll get comments from the panel now.
I'm so glad somebody said that. I mean, essentially, that was where I was coming from in the beginning when I said, if you don't want there to be a problem, don't connect it, in a sense. I mean, exactly. I think there's two answers, right, at either end, two extreme answers. One is, if you want to protect things, you either don't connect them or you make them as open as possible, rely on openness to be your protection. So open source, keep the problem-solving ability to be crowdsourced and to be open as well. And I think you're right that kind of thing is essential. We don't have the equivalent of a building code. You're completely right.
And of course, it's not, I mean, there's these extreme positions, but there's also lots of positions in between, which is the more functionality you have, the more risk you take on. So if we can, the degree to which we can limit functionality, we can improve our security. And that's just basic architectural things. Like my iPhone is one of the most secure platforms I can buy, but it is that way because it is limited in many things that it can do. There are certain things that it's just hard to make a program on an iPhone do. That's trivial to do on a desktop. This helps.
Okay. Let me get further comments from any of the panelists.
I was coming in from the airport to here, and the taxi driver was chatting with me, a beautiful day in Ottawa, and coming along the canal, I thought, wow, this is lovely. And he turns, he goes, you know, one day, it won't be me picking you up at the airport, it'll be an autonomous vehicle. And he said, it'll be in 10 years. And I said, wow, that's scary. You know, I'm not aware of a single invention throughout man's history, from fire to the wheel to the internet, where we didn't start doing it and expand it as quickly as we could before we figured out how it worked and how it might help us and hurt us. And in every one of those cases, we had to create structures and laws after the fact. We were always, our entire arc of history has been around, you know, repairing the plane while it's still flying in the air. So I agree with everything you said. I agree less that the way to manage security is to limit functionality, because then you limit the potential of the innovation to positively impact mankind. And I agree with David when he talked about this isn't all bad and scary. It's mostly good. How do we accelerate our ability to manage the bad and accelerate our ability to leverage the good, I think is how I would frame the concern you're raising.
Okay, I've got one other person from Carleton, if I could work them in. Justin Nacarato.
It's Justin Nacarato. Thank you very much, senators and panelists.
I wish we could
hurry
up the microphone.
Oh, is there a way to raise this up a bit?
You're kind of tall for that microphone.
Can you all hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you. But
I'll do my best here. So I'm a master's student at Carleton with the Department of Infrastructure Protection and International Security. And my question was for all the panelists. Hopefully you can answer my question, shed some light on my issue. It's in reference to Shared Services Canada, particularly its lackluster performance, in my opinion, to improve efficiency, reliability, and the security of government's IT infrastructures. For a bit of context, I have two examples of note. The first is in July of 2016, with various reports being released by Statistics Canada in relation to SSC to evaluate its own sort of impacts and the challenges that might take place with implementing some of SSC's various provisions and platforms. And what they found was there was a serious gap in reliability, accountability, effectiveness, and as well as affordability, not only with the delivery of the various programs and projects and plans, but all of these sort of limitations dramatically affected Canada's overall cybersecurity protections. And the second example was 2 years ago in 2014, when the Canadian Revenue Agency was hacked by a 19-year-old individual who used a common zero-day exploit known as the Heartbleed bug to steal over 900 social insurance numbers. And while the CRA was able to sort of mitigate its losses and protect its servers by shutting down, it was only able to do so from advice from the private sector, and it completely ignored the advice from SSC, who told them to keep their servers online despite signs of a major data breach. So from all of your presentations thus far, some of the themes that you've touched upon are sort of greater collaboration between public and private sectors and sort of a whole of government approach to cybersecurity accountability. I'm just wondering if I could get some feedback from any of you about perhaps the way forward for SSC or any other department that's going to be helping to facilitate greater protections for Canada's infrastructure.
Okay.
Good question.
Who wants to start?
Okay, Bonnie.
I've done some work recently. I sit as vice chair of a collaboration committee in the U.S. with the Infrastructure Security Partnership, which works closely with the Society of American Military Engineers. And in my own work, I've been dealing a lot with critical infrastructure issues. And I'm going to tie in the last question as well. People come at these problems with a number of limitations and parameters, financial in some cases, but it reminds me a little bit of a question I asked a pipeline engineer quite a few years ago now about how challenging is it really to get these pipeline negotiations going, and as an engineer, is it really that complex? Should you be putting in pipelines where in this one particular project, which I won't name? And he looked at me like I had three heads. He says, I'm an engineer. Either you can do it or you can't. And that was the perspective that he brought to his work as an engineer in that case. And it really drove home for me that people are coming at these issues from very different perspectives and with a very different educational background, a very different school of thought. And that collaboration piece, to me, really is the key. And all my experiences with working with critical infrastructure communities, 90% of which typically is owned by the private sector, and yet there's a public interest involved as well. So those dialogues from all those different perspectives and understanding where these different players are coming from is absolutely key, because the vulnerabilities and risks are many, and the more we can keep those dialogues going, the better off we'll be.
I'm not sure I'll be able to answer the full question. I'm going to just very quickly agree on that whole thing about perspectives. I remember in Kosovo, when I was there with the UN peacekeeping mission, my job was to negotiate security transition between KFOR, which is the military, and the local Kosovo police service that we were building up. And my opposite number was a Brigadier General Bruce Hood. And so we're talking about the concept of securing an area probably no bigger than southern Ontario with the same population of the city of Toronto at that time, 2.5 million. And we couldn't be further apart on how we would do it. And he finally got very frustrated with me one day. He goes, Peter, you're all about human rights and community policing, and that's all nice, but I joined the U.S. Marine Corps for two reasons, to blow things up and kill people. Now, he was being a bit facetious, but again, it's, you know, you're looking at the same problem, you're trying to get to the same place, a more secure environment, but you're coming at it from very two different personal and organizational ways. Sometimes you don't know what you don't know. In 2014, the private sector probably did say to the CRA, shut down everything, lock it down, let us come in and figure out what happened, and then we'll just do the issues management and the mitigation piece after. I know with the company that I work for now and many leading companies, it's the opposite. It's keep it running. Let's go in, do an immediate response to this thing. Let's figure out how they got in, how far they're in, what they have, what else they could get, but let them keep thinking they're in and secure, because once we've figured it out, then we can go on offense. And then, once we've gone on offense and interdicted this person or this entity, we can then share the information about defense, not only within the organization, but within the broader sector. So 2 years ago to now, there's been an evolution, a significant evolution, in terms of our ability to assess and address threats. I would suggest 2 years from now, we laugh at that statement because we're more sophisticated as a result of it. So I think the goal is not to look backwards and criticize, but to recognize that there needs to be constant improvement, and we will learn as we go. Fail fast, learn faster is what I would say.
Okay. Enough of that. Okay, thank you
very much.
We have 15 minutes left, approximately. I have three senators. I have one more person I've added on the list from the audience. We'll go back to the senators now. We'll try to get it all done, but we need to keep the questions and the answers fairly tight to get it done on time.
Senator Day, and then Senator Jaffer.
Thank you, Madam President. I think my question can be fairly quickly answered, because we've skirted around this issue of just what is the role, the legal and regulatory role, in this whole area. And traditionally, in the web, it's been considered that it's not a place for a lot of laws. And maybe you could talk a little bit about the dark web and how, if that is functioning without any regulatory scheme. But my question was in part brought about by Mr. Sorensen's reference to the Swiss system, and I got thinking about the banking information that was voluntarily released, and then this question Mr. Slowly mentioned the obligation to disclose if there's been a breach of customer information. There seems to be not a competition, but a balancing between the law and regulatory scheme and the cooperative association guideline type approach. Can you talk a little bit about that? And would for example, the requirement to disclose, this is another aspect of this, as a piece of legislation, would that be used not only from the point of view of investigation and helping to investigate, but also to help discipline a private sector company that doesn't like the public to know that its system isn't as good as maybe its customers think it should be?
Go ahead, and I'll follow you.
So, I, you know, full disclosure, I'm not a lawyer and only relatively new to the private sector. I think, though, what we're looking at is carrots and sticks. There's got to be an incentive to business to report more, to share more about their strengths and their weaknesses in order to, you know, a rising tide raises all the ships in the harbor. I get it. There's a competitive advantage to some degree to keeping your systems and your intellectual capital close at chest. But there are many, many examples in the internet age where companies have literally broken that model. some of the best Fortune 500 companies took their R&D departments and threw it out into the internet, and through wiki processes and crowdsourcing processes created more innovation at lower cost, and were able to get a competitive advantage as a result of it. So again, I'm not a business magnate, nor am I a legal person, but I think if we challenge the current system, in some cases you want to go more secure, in other cases you want to go more insecure, and then constantly learn from it, the good and the bad of each one of those, because none of them will be a perfect solution, either in the specific operation or in the overall strategy. But you continually innovate, you continually learn, and as I said, you fail fast, you learn faster, and where you've been succeeded, then you leverage that to a greater degree. And I believe in the internet has created, whether you want it or not, it's a sharing economy, it's a crowd approach to business and personal life that probably none of us, with the exception of the millennials in the room, are going to be comfortable with or particularly adept at. But it is a new reality. It's a new normal. Some of our old tried and tested methods of regulatory standards, legislation to guide and shepherd these massive changes are still going to work in the new normal. Many will fail and are already proving ineffective. And some are just going to be brand new approaches to government and governance that we've never attempted before but now have to conceive of and apply.
I believe that we need to be adaptive in our way and our approach, because we've looked at different types of cyber issues this morning. And each type of cyber issue brings along its own solution and ways. And the reason why we've been skirting most probably the answer you're looking for is the fact that there is no one answer to all of these issues. It's really a question of case by case. And you can push. I've been confronted under Sarbanes-Oxley to a situation where our client had to report, and yet we found sufficient grounds for reasons to request a further delay so we could keep our investigation ongoing, because we had reasons to suspect that not only there was an external issue, there were internal issues also, was possibly linked to organized crime. That's not the kind of stuff that companies want to make public. It will happen, and it does work by making the information public, but often enough it doesn't show a weakness within a system. I can quote, I believe, that a case I did a few years ago that was fairly covered in the media, and my client did disclose because they had an obligation. In this case, it was Bell Canada, who their list of clients, or a partial list of their clients, containing about 4.6 million client information, was taken away from their systems. Point is, it wasn't a break in or an attack or a hack into the system. A subcontractor's employee went ahead and copied that list directly from the system. He had his hands directly into the data. So basically, he just copied it and after that tried to sell the merchandise. It wasn't anything that much cyber, because basically he was selling a USB device filled with information. And I personally met with him to exchange the money and obtain the USB device in question. So Bell did disclose the information. The individual was charged and was found guilty in criminal court in Montreal. But it, again, in this case, we needed much more than just have an obligation to declare. We needed to have the time to investigate in this case. And the same thing goes for Sarbanes-Oxley. And under Sarbanes-Oxley, we were authorized 120 days further investigation in this case because we had acted immediately. One of the key issues on these situations is the fact that you need to be able to jump on the case immediately. There is no time to spare, because these crimes are being committed at a much faster pace than conventional crime. That's the big difference, and that's what we need to think about and look at.
Okay, I think we'll go on to the next question. Did you wish to respond very quickly?
Yeah, just on the question of disclosure and sharing more broadly, I agree with a lot of what Peter said, but I want to caution against the idea that actually sharing information, disclosure, is always a good idea. This is the opposite in some ways of what I said earlier on. But think about the Interpol system. This is the police, you know, system for sharing information across, well, and sharing investigatory practices across the world. One of the issues with this, of course, is are you always confident that police force X in country X is actually shares the same values as you, will understand the information which you share with them in the same way that you do, will use it in the same way that you would use it? And the answer is, of course, no. And so in some cases, you know, we're not actually talking about, it's the context in which information flows matters in some ways as much as the information itself that's shared, whether it's about a financial breach or whether it's about particular criminality and criminal issues. So just a note of caution on the idea that, although I generally favor openness, that sharing is always just some panacea to these kinds of things.
Quickly, Senator Jaffers.
Okay. Thank you very much. I first want to thank both the chairs for organizing. This has been a very interesting session. I wanted to first respond to what you were saying, Mr. Slowly, about the child abuse. One of the things, the Senate's done a lot of work on intimidation and is that we can't even keep our children secure in the home because this comes to their home in the middle of the night. They're intimidated even. Like they've at the school ground, at least at home, they had safety. Now there is no safety anywhere. At this late hour, I'm reluctant to address this issue, but something that exists and we have to deal with, and it's with cybersecurity and the issue of brainwashing. It doesn't matter what messages there are. How do you keep your children? How do you keep our population safe? And on issues where there is hate propaganda, there is all kinds of ways of brainwashing, especially our young people. Any thoughts on that?
An important discussion. Agreed. Late hour to give it full depth. It relates a little bit to the exchange that David and I had earlier on. You know, three slowly boys growing up in Jamaica, all under the age of 13, and our parents would just sort of open the door in the morning, having fed us, and let us run all over the countryside and into the gullies and hang out with the construction workers, and then hose us off at night, feed us again, and put us to bed. And that's not the world in Jamaica. It's not the world in Toronto where the Slowly Boys live now. And then my two children, I have to worry about them line of sight. If they're out of my line of sight, I immediately, even 27 years in policing, I perceive of the pedophile and the rapist. And now, even when they're in line of sight, but their heads are down on a screen, I have to think and ask and act. It's the new normal. It's not where I want it to be as a parent. It's not where I want my children to be. I can't conceive of what their children are going to cause them in terms of continual stress around safety and their new normal, whenever that is some decades down the road. I think it's very relevant to the conversation we're having right now. Again, similarly, there's no easy answers. As a parent, you just have to be constantly engaged with your kids. As a CEO of your company, you have to be constantly engaged with your employees. As a police officer on the beat, you have to be constantly engaged with your community in ways both in the physical space and in the cyberspace. And as soon as you think you're safe in one area and you can ignore the other area, you'll find that there's a threat at work there that you could have and should have seen and in some way prevented or at least mitigated the impact of it. It is the new normal. It's an expanded threat environment, and it requires an expanded and more complex set of approaches than we've ever had in human history.
Okay.
Just very briefly, I agree, but on the other hand, I think you can take this too far, and I think there's a great danger in over-monitoring and over-surveilling our children to the point where they actually react against the very intent that you have. One of the worst things you can do is to make children believe they grow up under surveillance from the beginning, and this is normal. And I think that the idea that we actually start monitoring our kids more and more to make sure we know what they are doing gives them the wrong idea themselves about what sort of an ethical way to live in an information society is. So I think to some extent we're all anxious about our kids. I have a 7-year-old boy who's like incredibly curious about the world. You can't stop him from finding out about the world. But to some extent you have to still do some things like let them go outside and play. You can't be responsible for keeping them entirely safe. It's not even possible. You end up with an incredibly paranoid society. And I should also point out, just from the social research that we know, that, and this is not referring to anybody in this room, but the vast majority of child abuse whether it's physical abuse or sexual abuse, occurs within families and by people who are known to the children. The idea of the remote predator is still the rarest form, whether it's online or in the community, is still, you know, outside, is still the rarer form of child abuse. Just bear that in mind when it's like everybody out there is a danger. It's not actually always like that.
Okay, I'm going to take the, to finish up, the one more question from the audience. Jeff Wilkie, Advantage IT, for a quick comment or question.
I'll keep it quick. My organization does a lot of work in IT security services with companies in Canada. And one of the comments that I want to make is don't forget about education and awareness, because we walk into organizations, especially small business, and they are completely oblivious to how exposed they are. They have no protection. They're collecting credit card numbers every day. That's sitting on servers that are, you know, out of date, you know, not sitting behind a firewall. And, you know, they're small business people. They're not, you know, they don't understand that world, this world, the IT world. But they're exposed. And I think as part of, you know, October being, you know, cybersecurity awareness, I mean, we need to take that further to, you know, even in organizations where we have health and safety committees, well, maybe that should be extended to the same type of thing to drive awareness. You know, when we do full risk management programs with customers, part of that is education for their employees so that they understand, because a lot of things, when you sit down and explain kind of what they, you know, and when we have those conversations at the corporate level with the employees, they take that home as well and talk to their kids about it and all the rest, and it just helps to make sure that they don't click without thinking, right? I mean, that's always my message. Think before you click and look before you click, because, you know, there's a lot of things that can go wrong really quick. So education and an awareness, I think, is something that needs to be part of all the good things that you're talking about doing at the back end, but, you know, the people on the street, the customers, for our customers and the companies and the individuals need to be more aware without scaring them, because sometimes we have the conversations and they leave the room kind of, you know, shaking in their boots, but there needs to be ongoing education.
Thank you very much for that. I'll ask the panelists if they have any comment on that or any closing comment at all. Yes.
I agree completely. There are some fantastic education efforts underway. That kind of balanced early education approach is challenging, largely because teachers in teachers' college or university aren't even getting the cyber background in order to teach their students. And so some of the groups that are working very hard on this point is ICTC, IEEE, Stop Think Connect is a good program. There are many others. I'm not doing it justice, but getting that into the schools and even into the teaching colleges and programs is critical.
Peter.
Again, thanks for that great point, and I'm glad it was the last one we're going to focus on. I stated in my topic, this is more a prevention than a response effort at all levels, whether private sector, policing, or government. And I loved, Bonnie, what you said earlier on. It reminded me of a conversation I had with Chris Pogue, who for me is one of the best cyber experts in the world. This is a human issue. Ultimately, this is a human issue. It's not a technology issue. And so it has to start and end with a human solution. And the best solution we've ever had in the human history is a better education of our young people, of all people, but particularly investing in our young people. There's some great examples coming out of the UK around educating people starting in junior grades all the way through to tertiary levels, and educating small and medium-sized businesses, particularly as you talked about. That is the driver of the Canadian economy. And so we're spending a lot of time talking about CEOs and large-scale companies, the banks, and the financial industry. The most people in this country are employed by small and medium-sized businesses, and they need way more help than where the big companies are. So I'm really glad you brought that up, and it's been an honor to be part of the panel.
Well, okay. This is one of those sessions where I started out knowing very little, and I end up knowing a lot more, but I end up knowing a lot more about what I don't know. But it's been terrific, this session, and I thank our four panelists who brought great expertise from different perspectives to bear on the issues. And colleagues, it's now up to us to think about what we might do next here in the Parliament of Canada and how we can help advance the kind of ideas that have been put on the table today. So I'll ask Senator Tardy for her closing comments.
Je n'ai simplement qu'à dire merci. Merci à vous tous d'avoir partagé votre expérience, votre expertise. Merci aux participants de l'auditoire qui ont participé et merci aux sénateurs aussi qui sont là aujourd'hui. Thank you. It's been very, very enlightening. Merci.
Thank you very much. The meeting of the Open Caucus is adjourned.